The government of Kaduna State notes with great concern video clips circulating on social media platforms like WhatsApp, in which citizens of a particular ethnicity are being massacred and their properties destroyed in parts of Nigeria. This is coming amidst avoidable rhetoric, frenzied ethnic profiling, and unlawful eviction of citizens from their places of domicile. Many citizens of Kaduna State have reached out to me as their governor to confirm the authenticity of these video clips. Some allege that these incidents have the support of the leaders of the places where attacks have occurred. While I'm unable to confirm the authenticity of the video clips, their impact on the peaceful coexistence of our people is a source of concern. On behalf of the government of Kaduna State, I call on all Nigerians living in our state to respect law and order and the rights of all citizens to live in peace and security wherever they reside or work. I appeal to my colleagues governing other states in our country to make similar statements and disavow these attacks and massacres. We must avoid anarchy and vigorously promote the rule of law and the right of all citizens to life, liberty, and livelihoods wherever they choose to reside. Elected and appointed leaders across the country must act on their constitutional obligations to protect all citizens, uphold order, and contribute to a climate for peaceful resolution of all issues. In Kaduna State, we are learning from decades of unfortunate and needless experiences. We have faced the tragic manifestations of the indigenous settler divide. This has been compounded by criminal activities that often have fatal consequences. But the victims of criminal actions like banditry and kidnapping in our state cut across all ethnic and religious groups. We have resisted the attempt to tar all members of any ethnic group for the criminal actions of some of their members. At all times, our government has upheld the right of every citizen to live in peace and pursue legitimate livelihoods wherever they choose. This is why we ordered the arrest of persons who issued an unlawful eviction notice to our citizens of a certain ethnicity in 2017. The impunity and calculated disregard for a common humanity that prompted such irresponsible rhetoric is sadly at play again. The genuine fears felt by people across the country for their safety and security imposes a responsibility on all leaders to ensure that these anxieties are assuaged and urgent steps taken to relieve human misery and stop the criminal actions that menace our citizens and their property. This should be the top priority. It is time for governments and leaders at all levels to step in, exercise firm action, engage people, and ensure that the responsibility these dire times demand are not derailed by those who only see opportunity for their own myopic agendas. We cannot allow, by inaction or otherwise, the reign of anarchy where fear creates a tragic momentum of violence, blurring the lines between victims and perpetrators and complicating a difficult moment. We urge our representatives in the National Assembly to expedite action on the constitutional amendments that will usher in state and community policing, as this is the ultimate panacea for effective law enforcement nationwide. We should not allow the criminal actions of insurgents and bandits to tear our country apart. We should not be seduced into the dangerous passion of blaming innocents, declaring them guilty of the crimes of others, evicting them, killing and destroying their property. In difficult times, we must uphold the right of everyone to live with security and safety. The frenzy of ethnic labeling makes solutions difficult and can only guarantee disorder, violence, and pain. Governments and security agencies must rein in all non-state actors, tackle hateful rhetoric, and protect all communities. Those that engage in criminal acts must be arrested and prosecuted without regard to their ethnic or religious persuasion. Civic leaders across ethnic and religious lines in all our communities should also help calm the heated passions of the moment, lest the few destroy the many, turning victims of crime against each other to the delight of those who do not mean our country well. We cannot quench one fire by setting more places ablaze. Let us reject the path of disorder, marginalize, expose, and prosecute all criminals and promote peace. Thank you, and God bless Kaduna State. God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
Please tell us what really happened. What happened to your car?
We went for the stakeholder membership registration sensitization program at Banquet Hall. So we just see that the governor mobilized people from different local government. They were shouting. We didn't talk. So after that, they asked us to come in for the program. That's what we just saw. We just went. They attack our state chairman. They hold his clothes. They want to tear his clothes. Later on, they were throwing chair on us. After that, before I go outside, they have destructed my car. They pack the money because I'm a businesswoman. They pack all my money, the gold that I want to return to my mom, they pack everything inside the car.
Could you recognize any of those people that you think did this?
It's not that I don't recognize them, but the SA domestic to the governor, they used to call him SOJ, and the SA political, SA women and empowerment, that's Yalamule. They were the one that instructed the boys to go and destruct my car, because they were shouting that Yalamule have given them the order to go and destruct the car and the SOJ.
So what do you think could be responsible why your car, since you are in the same party, why should they destroy?
They said that I'm not loyal to the governor, that I'm with the party. And without party, there is no governor. Because during this election, they did not write the AA in the ballot paper. They wrote APC. So why all this?
So what do you want from the national leadership of your party to do now?
They should take step. Because if they want to lose Kwara, they should not. They can lose Kwara on this issue. They can lose Kwara because AA did not have anybody, and no BOB, no membership card, membership registration in Kwara State.
No.
There's this rumor going around that you were attacked. Is it true? If yes, could you please tell us what exactly happened? How did it happen? When, where, and time, sir?
Well, it's not a rumor. It's actually real. What happened was that yesterday, about this time, the chairman of the registration committee posted to the state. I think the committee is about is a seven-member committee. Senator Damboy is the chairman of the committee. He was the one that sent message to me that I should forward a list of party members who are stakeholders in the party, who the committee we want to meet for today at the stakeholders meeting, scheduled for today. This stakeholders meeting is expected to precede the registration exercise in the state. Well, so it happens in other in other states, in APC states. So exactly yesterday night, I was able to send the list to him, the list of stakeholders. I can't remember the exact number now. The list includes that of the National Assembly, that of the governor, the deputy governor, the state assembly members, elders of the party, and other notable critical stakeholders of the party. So I forwarded the list to him. Well, the meeting was scheduled to hold at about 12 noon today. What I first saw was that at the banquet hall where the meeting was to take place, I was at the car park, and after having waited for about 1.5 hours, I had to send message to the chairman to ask him what was happening. That the message that was sent to me and to other party members was that this meeting will commence at about 12. It was already 1:30, and quite unfortunate, even the banquet hall was still under lock and key. We never knew that somebody somewhere was up to a game. At about 1:45, thereabout, we heard that the committee members were already inside. So we made arrangement. We started the APC stakeholder that went with me. They started moving in one after the other. So when it was time for me, as I was about entering the gate, the one woman called Abibat Bojua, which I know very well as a regular supporter of Governor Abdurahman Abdulrazak, she came around, held my shirt. She rough-handled me, baby. As a woman, I became helpless. There was nothing I could do. But the people around had to find a way of getting her hands off me. And forcefully, I was able to enter the hall. But as I entered, that was when I discovered that it was a grand plan. It was a grand design by the governor's men to prevent APC members from getting into the hall. That was when I discovered, because by the time I got in, we discovered that those at the gate, those that man the entrances of the hall, are supporters of the governor. So they were the one that made the arrangement that prevented the APC members from going in. But when the chairman, the Regional Committee chairman, when he saw that, he was not happy. Because he saw what happened to me. He heard what happened at the gate. I approached him and he saw my clothes, how I was rough-handled. Then he said that he was surprised at that, because he never expected that. He said he called this meeting and he expected every stakeholder to actually come and attend the meeting. He said this meeting was neither organized by the party at the state level nor the government. So everybody should be allowed entrance. Everybody should be allowed free access. He was not happy at what happened. Unfortunately, it went beyond that. When we were inside, just suddenly, some talks led by Obasanjo Alasi. Obasanjo Alasi is the SA domestic to His Excellency. He led some boys into the hall and they started beating up everybody, to the extent that most of the party members, they were wounded, vehicles were vandalized, properties were snatched, and things like that. That was what happened. As I'm talking to you, the state treasurer of the party, he was beaten to a state of coma. He was beaten, he was wounded, even to the extent that one of his teeth was even removed. Possibly, I think he should be, he's been in the hospital now.
By what name? What's the name of
the name is Alhaji Dantala Yaro. The car that was, one of the cars that was vandalized was that of the state human leader, Alhaji Aramat Olaide. The car was smashed. One barrister, we have addition or two, he was also wounded. We have one Toib. Also, so many of so APC.
Can you quantify like how many people were wounded?
All together, I think we should have. I think about 10 people were wounded. They sustained various forms of injuries.
Okay, Chairman, this crisis, did it happen in the presence of this national executive member, the committee member that came?
Of course, they were in the hall. We saw them throwing chairs. They were in the hall. If the chairman of the regional committee, in fact, the chairman of the committee, the other committee members, they were ferried out of the hall because they were not happy. They saw all that happened, to the extent that the chairman himself complained to me that he didn't expect this kind of thing to happen here, because this is the came for registration exercise in which every member of the party must be allowed to register. So he said he wonder why will anybody prevent any party member from entering into the hall.
What do you think could be responsible for this, and what's the way out?
I wouldn't know what could have been responsible. I wouldn't know what would have warranted this, because the ideal thing is that this exercise was put in place by the national body of our party, and the rule that follows is that every member of the party must be allowed to register. And I guess what is possibly happening, that some people somewhere are afraid, they want to shut out some members of APC from registering. I guess that is what it